a lot of this is going to be not only official CLE stuff for the intellectual disability, but it's also kind of understanding who I am, getting to know me a little bit. Because I've really spent about 20 years, 25 years working with intellectual disability, autism spectrum, other developmental disorders, and even traumatic brain injury. So I've got a lot of that, what we call neurocognitive experience there. The forensic side of it, as a neuropsychologist, I often got hired by civil cases to do expert witness neuropsych exams and that type of thing for personal injury. And so I got very comfortable on the civil side of it, doing depositions and testimonies and, you know, expert witness reports and that type of thing. So the criminal was not too much of a stretch to go into there. I've also been a Social Security disability examiner for probably the first 15 years of my practice. So the forensic assessment is very familiar to me. In fact, I've kind of joked over the years that and said, I'm not a very good psychologist, I'm not a very good counselor, but I'm a hell of a psychologist, because I'm much more on the diagnostic side. And I'm more of a behaviorist. So I'm not worried about how somebody feels about the situation. I need to know what is going on, what they're doing about the situation. And so a lot of times, the people that I see, I have to look at how are they functioning day in and day out. That's what's called adaptive functioning in terms of the presentation. But it's also how well is the person able to function within their world. And we have to understand that their world may be a whole lot different than our world. And so that's kind of one of the challenging areas that a lot of people deal with. If you're working with homeless population or a veteran population, they all have a different perspective, a different life experience that they're bringing. And understanding where they are and meeting them there is kind of half the battle of doing a forensic type of evaluation. So the point of that is I've got about 20 years or so doing that, very comfortable with it, and very comfortable with attorneys, in front of judges, on the stand, that type of thing. Probably the other thing I need to let you know is I'm not wearing a tie today because I'm rebelling. Well, actually I am. I had 12 years of Catholic education and had to wear a tie every day for 12 years. And so unless I'm actually on a witness stand, I'm probably not going to have a tie on. I figured I paid my dues and I have to answer for it in the afterlife. So in the meantime, in Austin, Texas, I'm going casual. So that's also kind of what drives how I do my evaluations. Especially when I was working with the head injury population, we have to be real. And this slide kind of gives a historical perspective of what it means to be real. Every one of these terms up here, if you look at them, if you can actually see them from in the back, some of them may actually make you cringe. It's like, oh man, I can't believe he actually put that on the board. What happens in mental health is that we have a concept that's called derogatory creep. And so we take a neutral term to try to describe something, and it doesn't mean anything. But over time, society begins to look negatively on whatever that condition is. And then those formerly neutral terms become very ugly, very derogatory terms. And so here's just kind of a sampling of what we've had over the last 100, 150 years of how we refer to those with low cognitive abilities or intellectual disabilities. I mean, even down to cretin from the Middle Ages is where that came from. We still use that term today. Hopefully not in public, but it's still used. So one of the other battles is identifying that mental retardation, intellectual disability now, there is a real person behind that. It's not an ugly term. It's not somebody who's an imbecile, who's a cretin, who's a moron. Those are ugly, ugly terms by our society, thankfully. That being said, I will apologize because you may hear me slip back into the mental retardation category every now and then. So I'm going to apologize up front if that sounds offensive. It's a bad habit I haven't quite broken yet. Intellectual disability over time, and I realize this one is almost impossible to see back there. Even as far back as Greece, we realize that people with low cognitive abilities, there was some kind of imbalance in the system. And here, Hippocrates referred to it as an imbalance of one of the four humors. And that kind of kept going for hundreds of years. We finally get to the Middle Ages, the 13th century, and England figured out that, okay, these people need some help in day-to-day functioning, and so England actually started the first guardianship program. That was about it for another 400 years. Then we began to identify intellectual disability as some type of illness, even though we didn't really understand it. Then in the 18th and 19th centuries is when it got really exciting. That's when we built great big hospitals and institutions and called them asylums and just locked people in there. That's the story of Charles Dickens. That's the horrible stories that a lot of people in society think of when they hear the term intellectual disability or mental retardation. They're thinking of, I don't know, Hunchback of Notre Dame, chained up in the bottom of the cathedral type of thing. And so we still have to fight a lot of that. We get into the 19th century, and a term called eugenics comes around. This is a Darwinian, Charles Darwin type of aspect, where Darwin said, hey, these people have a mental illness, they obviously have flawed genes, and we don't want to pass those on because they're not adaptive to the human race. And so the concept of eugenics came out to start breeding these people out of society. Now, this was probably 3 or 4 months ago. A little USA Today article pops up on my newsfeed or whatever. And in the country of Denmark, they still practice a eugenics as a governmental policy. And in Denmark, of all the women that have prenatal exams, if it is determined that that child is going to have some type of genetic disorder, especially Down syndrome, there is about a 99% abortion rate, pregnancy termination rate. And so a lot of the westernized European countries still kind of practice this quietly. Most of the physicians still say, hey, we can relieve you of that burden before it ever happens. This is 2017. We like to think we're a little advanced, but in much of modern civilized society around the world, it is still looked at as this person is a burden, this person that does not have any worth or value to society. And so that's still a lot of battle that we have to fight. In 1905, so just barely over 100 years ago, we finally got what we call an IQ score. An IQ score originally was developed as a term of mental age. And so we can take an adult, and an IQ gives us an estimation of where they are in terms of their development. And so for a long time, most of those 100 years, we referred to somebody with an IQ of 70 or lower as not only were they mentally retarded or mentally deficient, but they were also at about the level of maybe a 6-year-old child or an 8-year-old child. If they were lucky, maybe a 12-year-old child. IQ scores, we don't really use mental age so much anymore. There are a couple of tests out there that still refer to it. They are not the mainstream test, but it's still out there. The important part of that is, though, when I look at an IQ score, and then I have to do what's called an adaptive measure, which I'll talk about in a minute, those adaptive measures are literally a direct translation back to physical and mental development of the individual. And so if I'm talking to you as consultant to the attorney, I'll say something to the effect of, you know, your client is really only functioning like a 7-year-old kid. And once I do that, then everybody kind of goes, oh, because you've either got one of those or you had one of those in your house. Or you know somebody or you've got a family member. And so the mental age is still kind of valuable because it really helps make understanding an IQ score a reality. It's like, oh, now I get it. That's why when I talk to him this way, he doesn't get it. But if I do this, then he understands. And so if you've seen any of my reports, I've had a couple so far where I've actually mentioned that we have to keep the terminology at a certain level. We have to keep very concrete, very short sentences type of thing. And because we're basically dealing with a 7 or 8-year-old child in a grown 200-pound body. So a lot of that stuff still comes around. So it's not really about an IQ score so much as it is, how do we meet that person where they are to get them to understand what's going on, so that I can convey to you guys as attorneys, hey, this is what your client really needs. It may be punishment for something they did. They may not have known that they did anything wrong, first of all. But maybe this is an unidentified condition that we need to work some case management and get them some additional services. And that's probably the bulk of really what I do up in Lubbock is the case management aspect. That's a hugely underserved area and a very large population area. And so I do a lot of ex parte IDD evaluations just to get them social services so they don't keep coming through the courtroom every 2 weeks. Or when they get into a fight with the caseworker at the group home, that criminal charges aren't automatically filed. So it's the long-term effect is we got to get them the services they need so that they can get the care they need and release the burden on the justice system. Okay, so jumping forward, 1970s is when we started looking at intellectual disabilities to normalize them back into society. A lot of us have seen the movies, heard the stories, knew a neighbor who had a brother or somebody that was a little slow, and so they would usually keep them in the basement, give them a room in the garage, and they never really got out in public. Even in schools, we used to have separate classrooms. Now we call it mainstreaming. What we're trying to do in that sense is work on the adaptive abilities of the individual. Try to get them to where they can function as close to independent as we can get them. It also helps to destigmatize their condition. So in 1980s, we had the Civil Rights of Institutionalized Persons Act signed by President Reagan, which gave them basically equal rights as a citizen. Before then, those with low cognitive abilities were considered almost less than human. So we're only talking, 30, 35 years ago that we started to say, hey, these guys are basically normal. They're just like you. Oh, okay. Excuse me, in 2010, President Obama signed into law what's called ROSA's Law. ROSA's Law changed the term from mental retardation to intellectual disability at the federal level. It was actually brought out of a lawsuit. It was an ugly term, and so they changed it from mental retardation to intellectual disability. And it took a couple more years in 2013 for the Supreme Court to finally recognize that, hey, we need to have a uniform definition, even down to the state and county level. So really 2013 is when we started to use a different term, switch from mental retardation to intellectual disability. So now we have intellectual disabilities. In my diagnostic manual, which is known as the DSM-5, it's what psychologists and mental health use to give a diagnosis. Intellectual disabilities are now considered what's called a neurocognitive disorder. So we're going to confuse it even more. We were starting to make some good progress, and now we're throwing a different category in there. A neurodevelopmental disorder means the person is not growing and developing the same because of some medical basis. That's the neuro part. I'm thrilled to death because when I started this, nobody could say neuropsychology. Now I get calls saying, oh my God, you're a neuropsychologist. We've been looking for one. So even in my 20 years, I have seen a huge shift into how people actually recognize what a neurocognitive disability is. Within that neurocognitive umbrella, we have intellectual disabilities, and there are four levels of them. And we also have developmental delays. Developmental delays are kids that we used to refer to as being slow. He's a slow kid. He's a slow reader. He has some learning disabilities. Those are children who are born with some type of condition that only affects them in one or two areas and maybe doesn't affect them so severely. And so a lot of the times I still hear things like high-functioning autistic, low-functioning autistic kid. What that is we're saying, what is the level of impact and the level of severity of that cognitive disorder? So when I really break it down, if you can even see the bottom, what I'm looking at is saying, hey, does this person have difficulty understanding information, problem solving, planning? What's their judgment? Can they understand abstract terms, which actually becomes very important in this setting? What's their academic learning? Can they acquire new information? Or are they tapped out? And so when we look at intellectual disabilities, that's all that comes into an IQ score. The diagnostic criteria, I'll run through fairly quickly. Basically, we have three conditions. Deficits in IQ score, deficits in adaptive functioning. And adaptive functioning, the best way to describe this for general population is if anybody's ever had children, probably most everybody in here has had some experience with somebody who was pregnant. They pull out the book, What to Expect When You're Expecting. And they go through and say, oh, well, this week your baby's the size of a cherry. This week your baby's the size of a peach. This week their baby's the size of a watermelon. I was actually going to school when my wife was pregnant and was reading this book out loud to me. It's odd to compare developing children to fruit, but the book does that. And so as we look at this, the adaptive functioning says, okay, you have a fully formed watermelon. What can that watermelon do? What's its life? And so when we look at the adaptive part, we have to know what it is as a person. Can it walk? Can it talk? Can it think? Can it care for its own self hygiene? Can that person follow a schedule? Does that person understand what's right and wrong? Does that person understand that if you agree to this, your punishment's not so bad? And so that's called adaptive functioning. So we've taken it just from you're a fruit shape to you're a thinking, performing, functioning human being. The adaptive functioning in my field is we take the what to expect when you're expecting descriptions and actually put them into a quantifiable questionnaire, basically, where some of those are referred to as the Vineland. They're referred to as the adaptive behavior scales. There's several of them out there. But in order to establish an intellectual disability, one of those things has to be done. If any of you were working or have ever had experience with the MHMR system, they have what's called the ICAP. The ICAP is acceptable, and it's actually quite a very good developmental measure. The whole point of that is we've got to figure out how they can function in these major areas of independent living on a day-to-day basis. And so just because somebody has an IQ score that's low, if they don't have that adaptive measure or adaptive rating done, we cannot refer to them as intellectually disabled. And that becomes important here in a few minutes when I start talking about the competency. And these conditions have to be present before the age of 18 in most cases. It can go up to age 25 in certain conditions if there's a medical disorder that goes with it. So if you're asking me as a consultant at some point, hey, do you think this guy's ID? The first question I'm going to ask is, do we have any documentation before the age of 18? Even if we don't, if I can still establish a pattern of low cognitive abilities, special education, a lot of medical conditions, head injuries, that type of thing, I can still get them qualified as intellectually disabled. What I find, though, in a lot of schools, and I hope nobody here is associated with AISD or any other school district, politically, the schools have been driven to the point where they will not identify or report a full-scale IQ. They'll do all the testing. I'll get 50 pages of testing information. Never will they report the full IQ because they don't want to have to identify that child as intellectually disabled, because that actually counts against them in their federal quotas. And so from a case management point of view, that is the most frustrating thing I deal with in my practice, is I have all the documentation and now I have to argue with a bureaucrat at Social Security and say, hey, this person was intellectually disabled. Well, we don't have an IQ score. Yeah, but. And so that was actually my very first case in private practice without a supervisor. Is I had to establish intellectual disability on a 52-year-old man. So I mention that because school records should be a nice, clean source of information. oh, great, we get that. And attorneys will wait weeks and weeks and weeks to get school records finally sent to them. And I'll look at it and say, sorry, that's garbage. I can't use this. I usually can find a way because I know how the system works. But don't put all your hopes on a case being made because you finally get school records on a client. I'm just throwing that out there for all you attorneys. Okay. Intellectual disability, mild, moderate, severe, and profound. Profound you won't see out in public. They are institutionalized because they require 24-hour care, just barely above needing constant life support system. Okay, so that is profound. Severe, you will occasionally see. Ann Richards, back in the day, deinstitutionalized a lot of folks. Problem is, society never really filled in that gap. And so a lot of those folks that are now older, that were displaced in the early 90s, are still on the streets 25 years later. And we still get them through the court system. And yes, I have run into severely mentally retarded folks living in homeless camps and on the street population. Unfortunately, at this point, there's almost nothing I can do. There's so much deterioration that there's not a whole lot we can do to help them other than keeping them safe within the criminal justice system. So case management on that one is very difficult. Moderate, I see a lot of. Because, and this is my colleague's fault, a lot of my colleagues, we like to use screening tests. And a screening IQ test will usually artificially bump up somebody's IQ score 10 or 15 points. State and federal guidelines say I have to use a full IQ test, not a screener, to establish intellectual disability. So this is the case where you guys get the records, and one day he's got an IQ score of 54, the next day he comes out at a 70. Do you have an intellectually deficient client? We don't know. And so that's kind of part of the other problem, is somebody will say, oh no, he's got an IQ of 70, by God, and I hate to say it, it's usually the prosecutors that say, he's got an IQ of score of 70 or 69, we're going to go ahead full force on this one. And then I come back in ex parte and do a full battery and no, they're an IQ of 56. I'm sorry, your multi-count felony charges just fell through. Because now we've got a whole different issue going on. So a lot of the folks we run into are actually in the moderate category. The mild are fairly easy to work with. Most of them probably go undiagnosed. Unless there's some severe mental, emotional illness that kind of goes along with it, then we'll see a lot more of the mild mental retardation come through. And that's probably the bulk of the difficulty in working with assessing competency. Because not only do I have a mental illness I have to worry about, but now I also have low cognitive ability. And trying to separate those two is a challenge much of the time. Hang on, I don't know if it's, okay. So, other factors that related to intellectual disability, primarily what you see is the individual has difficulty regulating their emotions. I can't tell you how many times I've had to do a competency exam on somebody who is clearly intellectually disabled because they got mad at the caseworker in the group home and threw a brush at them. Or they dropped the fork and it happened to land on the caseworker's foot. And so now there's an assault charge. It's like, oh, you've got to be kidding me. So I do see a lot of those. Again, it's the emotions. And they usually will come across as an assault. If they happen to grab a knife or a pencil or something that happens to be sitting around, now we've got a deadly weapon. So, and of course, the DA doesn't like to have those charges dismissed. You know, they want to see those types of cases prosecuted. But at the same time, this person really is not capable of being prosecuted. It was an impulsive reaction. Again, we're talking about a 5 or 6 year old level child in a 200 pound body. So those tend to cause the most friction when I do a competency examination. But I feel like, no, we need to establish that. And I really wish group homes would do a much better job policing their caseworkers and counselors. Yes, ma'am.
I could just throw in one thing here. So when you said about, you know, this is about a 5 or 6 year old child, I've heard prosecutors say to me, okay, well, first graders know not to hit. So they know what they were doing. So what's the response to that?
I'll get to that. All right, so other things that we see in clients with intellectual disabilities are socially inappropriate behaviors. Somewhere they miss the idea that you probably shouldn't self-satisfy on the public corner, okay? Most of the time, though, it's usually they get in somebody's face because they didn't recognize personal space or personal boundary issues. And if they're working in a home, or if they're in a homeless setting and approach somebody with a mental illness and violate personal space, well, now we have somebody who's paranoid schizophrenic blowing up at somebody who's intellectually disabled. And so, you know, that's not a good mix. So socially inappropriate behaviors, and they can range everywhere. Gullibility. This is probably the one that causes the most frustration for the DA when I come across them. Because the reality is drug pushers and counterfeiters like to find people of low cognitive ability to move their goods. Hey, I'll give you $100. I'll give you $200 of fake 20s to go ahead and drop this package off. I've seen sting operations fall through because that's what happened. Actually, the Lubbock DA was not happy with me for a long time because one of their highest profile sting cases was exactly that. Unfortunately, we caught it before the federal charges came down. Otherwise, it would have been an even bigger issue. But that's part of the problem is you get a 17 or 18-year-old kid who doesn't know any better, is now given a package or a stack of counterfeit bills to move, and then they get caught. They're the ones who get stung. So gullibility can become a very, very big issue, and that one's pretty tricky to bring to the attention of the judge and the DA and others. Because you're right, on one hand, they should know what to do. If you asked them, should you give fake money? Well, no. Then why did you? Well, I didn't know that it was fake. Okay. So that's a little bit harder argument to make, but that's probably one of the more common versions that I see out there. Other things that we see is altered motivation. They just won't work with me. I can't get them to talk to me. They've got their head down all the time. Right, because if they don't understand the world around them, a lot of ID individuals will just shut down. And they will put their head on the desk. And they will just kind of stare off at the wall because they don't understand. They're overwhelmed, too much stimulation, too much information. The brain shuts down as a way of self-preservation. So can they interact with their attorney appropriately and reasonably and rationally? Eh. Maybe they have the ability to, but now they don't have the motivation to. But the motivation and ability often go hand in hand. So that's another tricky area that attorneys often will call me back on a competency report and say, hey, this guy won't talk to me. I think he gets it, but I can't really tell. So he's not working with me. Other conditions that happen out there, and I kind of alluded to these real quick. Autism spectrum disorder, what we used to call autistic and Asperger's. A lot of those can be of very low cognitive ability. ADHD. ADHD, you can have somebody with an IQ score of 70, barely at that cutoff range, but because they have ADHD, now they're not paying attention. They're impulsive. They're not hearing what you said. They don't get it. And so ADHD and ID often create kind of a tricky little combination. Honestly, most of those probably end up being competent in the long run. I'll just tell you straight up, because it's really hard to say, look, judge, if you speak in short sentences, use little words, and actually write it down for them, this person can understand. In fact, somebody in here was just in a live testimony with me when we had that exact issue. Depression and bipolar disorders, very common, especially bipolar. Bipolar has shifted over the years. That's a whole nother CLE. But a lot of intellectually disabled individuals do have some type of mental illness. Bipolar's the diagnosis of the day. And so usually it's because they're impulsive and get angry quickly, and so they now are considered bipolar. a whole, like I said, different issue. Anxiety. They may be fine one-to-one, but if you bring an individual with an intellectual disability and anxiety into a courtroom setting like this, ooh, now I'm not sure they're going to be stable enough to be able to stand trial under that standard. So, impulse control disorders, again, usually it's the anger that shows up. Individuals with cerebral palsy. Usually the intellectual disability is missed over the years because everything is just ascribed to the physical difficulties that person has. And so people never realize that cerebral palsy carries, in a lot of cases, low intellectual functioning, learning disabilities, and other condition, other mental, intellectual conditions with it. I'm not going to go through this one. This is very tiny, tiny words. Establishing an intellectual disability. Have to have an IQ score of less than 70. Not 70, has to be 69 or lower. Sort of. An IQ test has a range of error of about 8 points. And so if they score with an IQ of 69, then technically their range of ability is 62 to 77 or something. And so one day they may look borderline intellectual. The next day they look intellectually disabled. And a lot of times there's confusion in the records. So IQ has to be below as measured by a full battery. I've already mentioned my colleagues dropping the ball on this one. Frustrates the heck out of me. Low adaptive behaviors. Has to be present before the age of 18. Not the result of substance abuse. This one's a very gray area. And I've seen more of this one with the rise of synthetic marijuana, the cannabinoids. That stuff literally pokes holes in the front part of a person's brain. And so impulsivity, psychotic tendencies, anger often comes up. That is drug related. But once the effects of the drug technically have worn off, the chemical effects, those cannabinoids and bath salts and a lot of the synthetics leave long-term damage in the brain. When I was directing the brain injury rehab center, my most difficult cases were 19-year-olds who had literally melted their brains with synthetic weed. They're never going to get better. They're now in the system, and usually they ended up going through the criminal justice system before they ended up at our treatment facility. Synthetic, even though it says cannot be the result of, the reality is, yeah, I can definitely make a strong case for that, that any MHMR eligibility specialist will look at and say, yeah, this person's qualified. The diagnosis must come from a physician or qualified mental health professional. I don't think I have any of my other colleagues in here, so I'm going to say it straight up. A psychiatrist cannot really tell you if somebody is intellectually disabled. Psychiatrists, generally speaking these days, do not do any IQ testing. If you don't do IQ testing, you can't definitively say ID or not ID. And I've already had a couple in my short time doing these for the county, for Travis County. The psychiatrist said they're good, and I'm saying, not so much. Well, how do you disagree on that? Because psychiatrists in general don't do any psychometric testing. So the reality is, a psychiatrist and myself, we can do a quickie exam and probably come up with a real similar determination. But if you're pushing for trial or on a final comp eval, or if you get somebody back from Terrell or Austin or Vernon, we may still have some issue going on there with the IQ level and who actually did the evaluation. I don't like doing that because that throws me or my colleagues under a bus at some point. But in order to make sure that the defendant gets proper representation, that has to be considered. Lubbock DA had lunch and put that case out there very clearly and said, look, that person's a good evaluator. Except in this case, I gotta let you know, if you call a hearing on competency or a competency trial, you're probably going to lose this one because of the psychometric question. So I'm putting that out there, not hubris on my part, but the reality of most psychiatrists don't do IQ testing. So if you have somebody that you're concerned with or the records have a little variation in there, you probably need to request one of the couple of psychologists that do these. So, yes, ma'am.
I've got a question. So, sure. on evaluation reports mm-hmm. from psychiatrists,
yeah.
there's usually that statement on there that this is a person that does not have intellectual disability.
Right.
So that means nothing?
Right.
Clinically, I can do what's called a quick mental status exam, and I can estimate an IQ probably 90% accurate. Most psychiatrists probably can too. And so, like I said, unless you've got some indication that it just doesn't feel right to you or the numbers don't quite look right in the documentation you have, yes, you would be better off to go ahead and have a psychological testing done. So that being said, I would trust the psychiatrist's determination, mostly and in most cases.
So when they write that in their report, why are they putting that in there if they haven't done any testing or that testing?
Pretty sure it says something that this person doesn't appear to be intellectually disabled. That's one of those little outs that all of us are trained to do. Yeah. And in fact, the few I've seen out of Travis County, they have put that kind of qualifier in there. So, and again, psychiatrists are great. They do a good job. And I think the ones we have here, my other evaluators, do a good job. But if you have a case, especially felony level, yeah, if it goes to a competency hearing, that's going to be the first question I'll say you need to be asking me what testing was done. Okay? Yes, ma'am.
Well, sometimes they have collateral sources.
Right.
You know, they might have an IQ score, so mm-hmm. testing done, and then they have other records.
Yes.
That, so they can say that.
Yeah.
And
that,
but you're saying an ISD record may not be accurate.
That's correct. Yeah. I try to work with schools a lot, but they've just made it really, really tough. Because they're not playing by the same rules as the rest of us. Okay, so one thing down here I do want to mention is Health and Human Services, before all the shifting a couple years ago, actually came out with the best practice guidelines for establishing intellectual disability. And so not all evaluators even know those exist. And so if you ask me, I'll usually tell you, well, according to the best standards guidelines, this is how we can work it, or this is what's going to be the reality. So you may have somebody at one point says, no, this person was or was not ID, and I'll say, well, that testing didn't meet the best practices. We need to redo it. I do a lot of eligibility, what's called endorsements for MHMR, Blue Bonnet, Central Texas, and all those. And that is what I have to look for. Was proper testing done? And so many cases it wasn't. And the schools, again, like I said, often will intentionally not do that or not report it for that reason. And any records older than 15 years may not be, really need to be reevaluated. So if the school records are really that old, then yep, I'm probably going to say, yeah, we need to update them, especially if there's going to be a case management component that we need to start looking at. So if you got somebody who's ID, case management, I'm going to burn through these real fast. Guardianship. By definition, guardianship says this person cannot represent themselves, doesn't have the capacity to function independently. That's kind of one of my top criteria for competency. So if they have a guardian, they're not automatically incompetent, but boy, they're well down that road. And I'm going to have some really good evidence to show that if they already have a guardian in place, that they come out competent. That one's really tricky. Basically, if they have a guardian that's been adjudicated and assigned by a court, that's a pretty tough standard in the state, even in Texas, by our mental health standards. That's a tough standard, and if they've met that, then they're probably not going to reach my competency standard, which is down here in terms of the legal liability. Just to know that if there's a guardian in place, you might want to just kind of automatically use the motion for competency, because chances are it's going to come out, and I don't want to say favorable. A crime is a crime, but that is a mitigating factor that has to be considered. All right, alternatives to guardianship. These are fairly new, so we don't see a whole lot of these, but they are out there. Usually the most common one is the money management. Social Security recipients will have an assigned payee, family member, or a state appointed. If they have a payee, then we need to go through the competency because that's going to be one of those that's on the border. Okay? And a lot of them end up coming out competent, quite honestly. Powers of attorney. Yeah, you guys are attorneys. I'll let you decide on the validity of a power of attorney of a POA. But physician's directive. Now we're getting a little more serious. Management of community property. So these are all things that case managers more have to deal with, but they can affect how I'm going to look at a competency case if these things are in place for your client. You guys are all educated, highly educated. What's reasonable mean? And it's even worse when they ask me what's reasonable. There is no definition of reasonable. And so somebody can be delusional. They can think that they need to be wearing a copper tinfoil hat or something. But does it make sense within their world? And do we need to make a little more effort to get to their world to bridge that gap? So the reasonableness is difficult. Don't worry about the chart. I'm worried about the top part. The reasonable degree of rational understanding. So if we go through the facts, they need to be able to tell me more or less what happened, even if they're at the level of a 6 or 8 year old child. They can still tell you what happened. But is it rational? Well, I didn't get my after dinner Coke, and so I threw the fork at her. Okay. Is that reasonable and rational? Within their world, maybe. But is that criminal? You know, that's what I'm going to look at and say, well, in society at large, that's probably not a rational decision to not getting your Coke at the assigned time. And so that's where it starts to get really tricky. The Hope Foundation for Mental Health came out with these factors. Overwhelmingly, not only is intellectual disability there, but if you have an intellectual disability with a mental illness, the severity of the mental health, that's going to be the biggest issue to say, are they competent or not? So if you've got somebody who's ID and paranoid schizophrenic, you probably take that one to the bank that they're going to come out incompetent. Not always, but pretty close. Other ones down the list, hospitalizations. So many people don't get hospitalized even though they need it. So almost can't count those. Substance abuse, of course, huge area. Tools and information that I have to take into consideration when assessing competency and potential for restoration. What's their legal knowledge? Kind of the standard I use for the general population is, if you've ever seen an episode of Law and Order, did you understand it? Okay, if they understand the show Law and Order, then they're probably competent for a Class A misdemeanor charge. Just saying. Not always. And so, unless you've got a licensed physician that actually knows how to do the stuff, or a licensed psychologist that knows how to do the stuff according to the standards, then you need to relook at it. We have to follow best practices. We have state and federal guidelines now that say this is best practice. We have, you know, courts that say what's best practice. Sometimes they don't always mesh, and so we have to look at, you know, precedent there. Guardianship, is that an issue? Ability to understand the proceedings, the terminology, recitation of facts alone, you know, all that stuff goes into it. So, this just came out as of the changes to 46B through this last legislative session. Dr. Jennings out of Houston, probably familiar with Dr. Jennings, his voice of the defendant online, I think it was the October article. Yeah, in fact it was. Under certain conditions, individuals with an intellectual disability can be found competent. One of the big changes the ledge made in 46B this last time is actually separated, can you educate them to competency versus can you clinically manage any mental health symptoms to competency? The ledge actually split that apart. So there's going to be a lot of fallout from that one. But so not only can I have somebody memorize all these terms that they need to know? They got the flashcards down, but do they really comprehend what's going on? Is there something else that's overriding that? Maybe if they do have medication for schizophrenia, is that medication impacting their cognitive ability and ability to understand? So clinically and education may not always mesh very well. And we'll see where that one goes. So they can be restored. Even if they have an IQ of 67, we still may be able to restore them to competency. That's a tough road to climb uphill, and it's probably going to cost 120 days of inpatient restoration. So all of that is considered as part of a competency restorable or not restorable evaluation. Of course, we have to look at the facts of the case. I don't know if any of you guys watched the Unabomber deal. It's now on Netflix, but it was a Discovery Network show or something. The last episode of that miniseries was fascinating because it was about the Unabomber's competency. And so out of that, we actually have standards for preponderance of evidence versus the delusional nature. Is there enough evidence to override this guy's delusions, his belief system, and whatever? That same concept also applies to intellectual disability. Is there enough evidence there that says, however it happened, this guy knew what they were doing at the time was wrong, even if they're intellectually disabled? And if we can prove that, well, then we have to look at competency as a viable issue. So yes, they can be found competent and incompetent, and yes, they can be restored, but it may be very costly for us to find out. Any questions on any of that? That was a whole fire hose worth of stuff. Yes.
Where would a client go to be restored competency?
In Texas? Texas, we don't have a whole lot of options. I think what the idea is, what I understand from some of the mental health governor advisors, is that we are trying to get in jail restoration back in place. That's going to take several years before we actually get viable programs again.
I mean, because the psychiatric hospital isn't always the right place.
No, and it's usually not the right, it's almost the last place. Right. There are a couple of outpatient restoration programs in the state, usually not very effective. And if you've got somebody who is intellectually disabled, can't always get transportation, maybe is in a rural or outlying area, right, are they going to make it in time? Are they going to miss more than 85% of their sessions for various reasons? I mean, all that stuff comes into play. I can tell you in Arizona, and I don't know if any of you saw my stuff, but I'm also certified by the Arizona Superior Court for these, which theirs was a special training just for Arizona, which expensive and frustrating as heck. They, if it's a misdemeanor and somebody's not competent, they throw it out. And I'm already starting to see that trickle through Texas, where if it's a misdemeanor, not competent on an initial competency evaluation, they drop the charges and let them go. So I'm going to look over at the case. What's that? Those are on a case by case. Depends. Yeah, depends kind of on that one. But definitely if it's a B or what? Well, you guys probably know the guy, Phil Wishcamper up in Lubbock. Okay, a lot of you guys know Phil. Phil and I had lunch last week, and he said the more pedestrian offenses, Lubbock is now dismissing based on this presentation I gave them 3 months ago. Because, again, it comes back to the money. You know, is it really worth spending $80,000, $90,000 to try to restore somebody on, and your money and my money and your time and, yeah. Was that your?
There a particular IQ that there's just no way that there's a competency restoration that's gonna?
Yeah. If I go by the numbers, 55. The reality is, if they're coming in 60 or less than 60, you're not going to restore them. They just do not have the capacity. That's a 4 or 5 year old kid, honestly.
So that's the answer to your question about the first grader.
Yes.
4 years old.
Yes. Right. Right. There you go. yes, sir.
Do you any scientific studies that indicate the validity of the idea that can educate people into competency again? Any scientific studies back in that up? Okay, okay.
Scientific studies?
Yeah.
Or opinion pieces? I haven't seen any scientific studies. Yeah, and that I was kind of facetiously saying, show them the flip cards. That's what happens. They can memorize those freaking cards. They don't have any understanding of what they mean. Right.
Right. Today,
and I'll tell you, Vernon and Terrell, they will pull 6 months of clinical records and say, oh, well, we've seen them throughout these 6 months doing better than what they actually did during the comp eval. We're going to call them competent anyway. Yeah, that's been I've spent a lot of work on that one the last 3 months, because those hospitals have had a shift lately, and I don't know what's going on. But hang on, yes, sir.
Yeah, I know your presentation was on competency, but I was wondering, is it possible for somebody to be so intellectually disabled that it becomes a sanity issue, even if they don't have a psychosis or some other mental illness?
Yes, it does. The problem, though, is the standard used to be, and I'm talking 25, 30 years ago, do they know the difference between right and wrong?
Well, that's still a standard, isn't it?
It is. It's an easy standard. And unfortunately, it doesn't always hold up on cross-examination. but yes. And so if that can be answered, yes, they did know right from wrong, then that throws our sanity out the window almost. So it's not 100%. But that's a really, really low level, really low standard we have to clear. Yeah. Hang on. Yes?
Have you noticed at hospitals that they are teaching people that, like, they'll get their arrest affidavit and teach them what it says so that they can have factual knowledge?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. The factual knowledge is, that's a no-brainer, honestly. When I get to the do they understand and comprehend that judgment part, that's where it falls apart all the time. But yeah, and that's what Terrell and Vernon are doing a lot. Yes, ma'am.
Have you ever worked with or dealt with people who have such a language deficiency that they are incompetent?
I have a deaf person next week on my books. Yes, I have.
That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah. When we have, usually it's undocumented. Spanish primary language, we can still hit competency pretty quick, honestly. Because usually, even through a translator, and I should let you know my background. In the military way back when, I was trained as an interrogator. And so that's actually how I got into psychology. Which I probably shouldn't share that with you guys, but. And so, as with that, we had to do things in a foreign language. And so I learned German right before the Berlin Wall fell. And so I used to interrogate in German. And so now when I interrogate for competency in English, you're not taping this part, are you, Austin? When I interrogate for competency in English through a translator, I'm not really listening for the answers. The verbal stuff is really not important to me because it's the behavior that's really giving me the answer. I don't know if the translator is a good translator. I hope they're certified and good, but that's not always the case. But if I can look at the person and they'll kind of get this little twinkle in their eye before they answer, then I know I'm about to get a line of BS in Spanish or Arabic or Farsi or something. And I do see it a lot. So the behavior is probably much more important to me than the actual verbal answer. And that's pretty much with any case, quite honestly. So even with severe language deficits, we can get somebody, assess them for competency. Yes, ma'am.
Is there a problem with folks who have severe intellectual disability being able to meaningfully consent to the representation?
Depends if we have established ID before I walk in the door or after I walk in the door.
Okay.
I know that's a legal answer, but if I'm concerned that that person, or if I know that person, and came from a group home, I go through my confidentiality limits with them, but I really go back through, now tell me again what we're doing here. And if they can reasonably, semi-intelligently tell me what the purpose is that of the evaluation is, then I will mark that as a verbal assent. So I'm sure you guys know the difference between an assent and a consent. So, and it's, and under court order, quite frankly, I don't have to have either one.
Sure.
So, but I do try to make a distinction in my reports whether it was consented or assented.
You have a question back there.
Oh, you're hiding. I didn't know you guys were back here.
So I may have gotten this wrong, but for instance, where you talked about TBI, close head injuries, less than 25 can qualify for ID with the state?
Yes.
Like disability?
Yes. Yes.
So if my client is 25, and we have like affidavits from family members about 5 to 7 head injuries, 3 of which I believe are significant, and starting at age 5, like would that, along with mental health records and whatever else from now, be enough to...
Yes, that's actually a very solid case.
Yeah,
like if what you're saying is accurate, then yeah, that would be a slam dunk for me.
So thank you.
Okay. Yep. Yes, ma'am.
When I'm talking to a client, how reliable is their understanding of their intellectual disability when they're telling me,
right.
Well, I'm special ed.
Right.
And that's what they say, or they say, I'm MHMR.
Right.
And I don't know what that means to them.
Usually it means that they were what we used to call a slow learner. Yeah. And so they're probably not intellectually disabled by the numbers, but they did have some learning issue going on. Okay. And that's one that through a mental status exam, me or the psychiatrist, we can find out very quickly. It's interesting, in Lubbock, the attorneys have to be present during my comp exams. You guys don't, which thank God, because that would be a scheduling nightmare with all of you guys. Lubbock's a much smaller jurisdiction. But usually if you hear me or if you see in my reports, I go through a string of numbers, you got to say them back, and then I'll say, name as many fruits as you can in a minute. Those can estimate an IQ score like 90% accurate, just those couple of quickie tests. And so that's what psychiatrists do. That's how we can usually say within a reasonable degree that yes, this person has enough cognitive ability to understand what's going on.
Okay.